must look forward to.
Now, Geneva is in the news again with the UN questioning,
yes.
But I want to go back in time, and I think that there was a big battle fought in Geneva with Dr. Jahan Jatilaka when he was in the ambassador, and where with you supported. Can you tell us more about it? What was the issue then? Because I think he did led by him, and with you and your minister, you all did a wonderful job, and where the country was proud about it. And since the it's again we are talking of a letter from Geneva, that's what I'm asking this question.
No, I think that's a very important question. And let me say at once, I was a very minor part of that. The minister led the delegation, and of course Van did a fantastic job. And I think we have to go back some time on this. You know, there are some people, and I'm afraid this is in your foreign ministry, who thought that Van reduced relations with the West. He was held in enormously high regard there by everybody, including particularly the West, because whatever it is, even the Western ambassadors, who for political reasons had to introduce certain measures, understood and respected an intellect that never compromised. Now, what happened is that when he went there in 2007, there was a motion on the table led by the British. We had a situation where Philip Alston, and in all fairness to Philip Alston, I asked him, why was he so nasty about Sri Lanka? And he has been, when his original report was really very positive. And he had come here and looked at things in, I think, 2006. And he told me, your ambassador came at me like a bulldog, so I thought I should be like the same. I was a bit of a child,
yes.
Actually. And I thought this was done, and he said, no, a lady. So I then checked, it was Sara Fernando, a career diplomat, but in all fairness to Sarala, what had happened is that she had asked him for a copy of his report, and he had said, I don't give it, it's confidential. And I believe him, he was, he told me another instance of this. But when the debate started, some Western countries had extracts from it which were damaging to Sri Lanka, and someone had leaked it. And I think we know who. You know, it was someone in that office who was very bitterly anti-Sri Lanka. And I told Philip, you know, you should... He said, I didn't do it. I said, Philip, I'm not saying you did it. Why don't you investigate? You know, it's a bit like the UNDP stocktaking report on our Human Rights Commission. Very positive. It was suppressed. People here, the present UN head, UNDP head, hadn't been shown a copy when Louis Arbour came. The office in Geneva had not been shown a copy. It was deliberately suppressed by people out to get us. Brian did a wonderful job. I remember this was September 2007. And because he told those countries, if you have any questions, ask the Sri Lankan delegation. We answered every question possible. And then the British...
I remember that you all took them on head on.
And the British ambassador at the time was a bit of a John Le Carré figure. Very sort of strange guy. He had joined the Foreign Office. You know, he was a child soldier, I used to call him. Because he joined when he was 17. You know, as an office boy and worked himself up, I think. I don't know. He came up to Dan and he told me, your ambassador thinks he's won, but let's see how things work out. But I think in all fairness, the British at that stage had a particular agenda. You know, Dominic Chilcot here was a strange man. He was making his way in the Foreign Office. He's doing well, God bless him. But the successor, I think, has been much more enlightened now, and I think relations are much better. You know, that bit of aggression was part of that old colonial mentality that some people had. But 2007, Nick Thorne, as he was, had to realize his motion against Sri Lanka, which had been on the table as a threat, lapsed. So we engaged with people. We met with all the groups. And again, it's so funny because, you know, some Westerners say we were supported by China and Iran. China and Iran certainly supported us, but so did India, so did much of Latin America, so did the Middle East, so did the ASEAN countries. And, you know, Dayan was able to talk to them at their level and convince them that the Sri Lankan situation was a battle against terror and we were doing our best. And in all fairness, the Indians, the Chinese, all of them kept asking us, are you ensuring that the minorities are well treated? You know, they are the ones who told us, we appreciate your security concerns, but you know, as soon as possible, the IDPs should be released. And we said we would do it. The government pledged 180 days. It's done better than anticipated, because not 80%, it will probably be 100%. But those people kept asking us, but they did not use megaphone diplomacy. Unfortunately, a few Western countries did. Sadly, they keep getting information from wrong sources. I'll give you one example of what I think is pernicious. You know, the EU in 2007 called in our ambassador in Brussels and said, don't hold elections in the East. I mean, it's outrageous.
Yeah, this is straight interference.
Absolutely. And we saw the report. He said, our reports indicate, information indicates that elections will not be fair. And we know this is the case because in 2004 when we monitored the elections, we found they were unfair. So I went to this guy, he was a man called Timmons. Quite nice, but a bit, you know, yeah. They don't understand Sri Lanka, they don't study it, they take in. I said, Mr. Timmons, I can tell you who gave you your information. It was a couple of NGOs who we were aware of, and the TNA. And I said, those TNA MPs are the people elected in the election in 2004, who do not want an election now, because their claim that they are the sole representatives of the Tamils will be exploded. This was proved, because in that election, you may be aware that the mayoress of Batticaloa is a young lady. No one expected her to be elected. The TMVP had a candidate who was a former fighter, but he didn't get the highest number. I was astonished. You know the explanation. This young lady's father was a TNA candidate in 2004, but he was deemed by the LTT to be a supporter of the Eastern Tamils and the Karuna faction. On the day of the election, he was shot. The man who came top instead of him was forced to resign by the LTT and shot 6 months later. The LTT put in instead its own nominees, not elected. But the people of Batticaloa remembered this gentleman, and when the election was held, they voted for his daughter. And I think that is the type of story the EU should learn. These people who tried to stop us having elections, stop us allowing the people to exercise democratic rights. One of the problems with Ranil, I don't know whether you know this.
Raju, can we take a short break and continue with Ranil, because we'll be back with you in a moment.
Okay.